Good morning students, welcome to the session of microbiology class. Today we are talking about medical parasitology, a very important unit in microbiology topics. So medical parasitology, we deal with the study of animal parasite which can infect and produce diseases. So these parasites lives in another organism, we can call it as host. So we have a host in case of parasitology. And the parasite derive nutrients directly without any benefits to this host. What will happen? Patient will start getting constipation, gas, bloating, diarrhea, pain or ache in the back, joints or muscles, irritable bowel syndrome, allergies, increased appetite, itchy ears, itching in the nose or anal region, nervousness or grumpiness, chronic fatigue, lethargy or apathy, various skin problems, tooth grinding or clenching, anemia, excess weight, forgetfulness, vision problems or even problems in sleeping. These are the symptoms we are expecting in parasitic infection. Before going to parasitic topics, I would like to introduce some of the terms which we use in medical parasitology. The first thing, what is an ectoparasite? An ectoparasite is a parasite which lives outside the human body or outside the living host. That can be infestation by lice, mite or tick. So you call it as ectoparasites. Lice is an ectoparasite which lives outside the human host, outside the body. Now we have endoparasite. Now endoparasite leads to infection because they get inside the human body or in the host. Example, Ascaris lumbricoid. Ascaris lumbricoid is a parasite which enter inside the human body and leads to infection. So we are mainly dealing with the endoparasites. Then according to the habitat, we can call the host as definitive host or intermediate host. What is the difference? In case of definitive host, the host harbor the adult worm and the sexual reproduction of the parasite happens inside definitive host. For example, we have man in case of filariasis, man acts as a definitive host. Here, filariasis is a parasitic infection caused by Wuchereria bangrofti. Wuchereria bangrofti, you can find the adult worm of the parasite living inside human body. And the sexual reproduction also takes place inside human body. So it is a definitive host. So man becomes the definitive host. Then the next term is intermediate host. Intermediate host is a host which can harbor the larval stage of the parasite, where asexual multiplication, if it is there, can happen inside intermediate host. For example, man again becomes intermediate host in case of malaria. In case of malaria, the mosquitoes are the definitive host and man becomes the intermediate host. That means malarial parasite completes its sexual reproduction in definitive host, which is female Anopheles mosquito, and it completes its asexual reproduction in intermediate host, which is man. Then what is a pre-patent period or biological incubation period? So this is the time taken for the parasite after entry into the human body till it can be demonstrable in the patient sample. So we call it as biological incubation period. So you will know after entry of the parasite how much time it will take for us to demonstrate in the sample. That is termed as pre-patent or biological incubation period. Then reservoir host. Reservoir host is somebody who can harbor the parasite. Coming to an important topic under this, that is, what are the different sources of infection? So we get parasitic infection from different sources. So you need to know which are those sources and what are those examples. First, we have man as a source of infection. In parasitic infection, man can become source or the reservoir where the parasite can be detected. Example, amoebiasis, which is caused by Entamoeba histolytica, enterobiasis, it is caused by Enterobius vermicularis. These are the parasites where you get the infection from an infected human being. So infected human being is the source of infection. Then we have soil. So soil, we get contaminated with the embryonated egg or the infected larva of the parasite. For example, roundworm. Roundworm is Ascaris lumbricoid. Now this parasite lay eggs and which is going to the soil and contaminating the soil. From the contaminated soil, you get the infection. Whereas in hookworm, what we see is the infected larva may be present in the soil, and the patient who is walking barefoot may get the infection by the penetration of that parasite larva to the skin. So here the source of infection is soil. Next we have water. Water is a source of infection in many infection in the form of cyst, intermediate host, infective larva, free living parasite, you get the infection. How do you get the infection? You drink contaminated water. It may contain the cyst of some parasite. Example, Entamoeba histolytica. You drink the water, you get the amoebiasis infection. Sometimes you drink the water or you come in contact with the water which is having the host, intermediate host of that parasite. That happens in case of guinea worm infection, where cyclops may be present in the drinking water or cyclops may be present in the water which harbor this parasite guinea worm. Then sometimes you get the infection because of contact with the parasitic larva which is infective, that may be present in the water. Example, schistosomiasis, where the larval stage is called Circariae, and this Circariae will be present in the water. So here also water becomes the source of infection, and sometimes the parasites directly enter which will be present in the water. Example is Naegleria fowleri. Naegleria fowleri is a parasite which can be present in the water, swimming pool, and coming in contact with the water, the parasite directly enter into the system. Then we have the source of infection, food. So your food may be contaminated with different parasites, maybe because of the fecal contamination or maybe directly from the food which may be in the raw stage or uncooked stage. So we have a meat containing larval of stage of the Tinea parasite which is called as measly pork. So these are the some of the examples where you get the infection directly from the food, that is beef tapeworm you get by ingesting cow, which is infected with Tinea infection. That like that we have pork tapeworm from pig, fish tapeworm from fish, liver fluke from molluscus, and guinea worm from copepods. So these are the food items which can give you infection, where the food is already infected or the animal is infected with the parasite. Then what is the next source of infection? Insect vector. Insect vector can be divided into two types, biological vector and mechanical vector. Now what is an insect? Insect is a vector which can transmit many parasitic infection. So based on how it transmit the infection, it can be classified into biological vector and mechanical vector. What is the difference? In case of malaria, mosquito become a biological vector. That means the mosquito, inside the mosquito's body, the malarial parasite complete part of its life cycle and complete another part in the human body. So mosquitoes are very essential for completing the life cycle for the malarial parasite. So without mosquito, it cannot complete the life cycle. So you call this mosquitoes as biological vector, where it also take part in the life cycle of the parasite. Whereas we have mechanical vector, where housefly is an example in case of amoebiasis. Housefly is not much required for the completion of the life cycle of the parasite, but it just help in the transmission of the infection. So we call it as mechanical vector. So we have two types of vector. Housefly is a mechanical vector, mosquito is a biological vector. And then we have animals. If you have close contact with animals, you are going to get many infections where the animal is infected. So animal, if you are coming in contact with dog which is having hydatid infection, which is echinococcus granulosis, close contact with the dog, patient gets hydatid disease. Same way you get toxoplasmosis caused by Toxoplasma gondii if you have a close contact with a animal, cat, which is having the infection. The last source of infection is autoinfection. So these are the different sources of infection. We just started with the parasitic topics, so I'll continue with the next video. Thank you.